Welcome to episode 53 of the Movie Lighthouse, shining a light through the fog of film. My name is James.
I'm Spartacus.
And I'm Vincent Van Gogh.
Do you know what? I can't stop listening to the theme from Spartacus. The Adagio, I think it's called. I don't know.
Can you know?
I'm going to play a bit now. I'm a massive fan.
Wow.
It doesn't sound like it would be in Spartacus either.
Isn't that good?
Yeah.
And when's this happened?
About three weeks ago. Yeah. Someone played it. I think someone had it on their Desert Island Discs. Wow. I have a very thin avenue for getting music these days, and that's one of them.
And the other is The Archers.
Yeah, which they don't play very much music at all, really. Except the tum, 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 tum.
Oh.
Yeah.
All right. Lovely bit of music, that.
Lovely bit of music. Right. So, first things first. Because Laurie Carr wants to try and find a way to justify putting his own choices through our film selection process, we have now been forced to change our five-year running format of quickly spotting some films at the end of the podcast.
Well, this was Windy Bum's idea. This is not my idea.
Say it was your idea, but you're going to exploit it, I imagine.
Yeah, probably.
So,
well, basically, what would happen, you know, you'd go into your ball bag, you'd pluck the ball, none of us would have a clue what it would be, and then we have, like, at the end of the record, you know, we're all sick of each other. We have to quickly choose two films to put on the table for whoever's choice it is to decide what film we watch. Right. And obviously, Wyndham's not too bad. James, you're great at it. And I'm take a while. I'm known to take a while. And it's quite a stressful thing. So Wyndham came up with the amazing legend of an idea, just saying maybe we could, you know, unzip your ball bag.
Right, so what we're going to do, because I was thinking about re-edit and doing edits and all that, that's all nonsense. So what we are going to do at the start of the show, i.e. now, we will be choosing the category for 2 months' time. And then at the end of the show, we will reveal our choices for next month. Does that sound clear enough?
Yes.
I'm going to say yes.
No, I am going to be choosing right now. And today's ball of choice is number 41.
Good number.
Is it though?
It is if you're 40 years old and you're hoping to make another birthday.
Yeah.
I guess so.
Silver linings, come on.
Oh, right. So it is a category.
Righty-ho.
And who gets to choose in 2 months? I get
you
to
do.
Choose. Is it me? Great. The category is Video Nasties.
Video Nasties?
Ooh, yeah.
First time you've been complimentary about a category ever, I think, Laurie.
Ooh, yeah.
Well, there we go. That's basically our genre. We did this, so there we go. Video Nasties.
Brilliant.
Also, in other news, I took out your golden ticket by accident, Laurie, so but it's back in there now.
You twat.
All right, so let's have a little bit of news. Right, you've got some.
I mean, it would be remiss, even though I'm bored to tears of it, it would be remiss not to talk about it, wouldn't it? The Oscar slap.
Oh,
jeez.
I'm quite enjoying the whole thing, really. As ever, I've completely misjudged it because I was up very early, so I heard about it at 4 a.m. and I was just thinking, oh, good for you, Will.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, he's got some problems, isn't he, I think. To do that, it's just really like, what? And obviously, at that night, he must have kind of had a feeling that he's probably going to win the Oscar. He's probably feeling like the Daddy Mac, and then probably really pumped up. And he just, to even think that he could do something like that on that kind of stage is like, whoa, that's it pretty feels like fucked up stuff.
A lack of thought, wasn't it?
Well, apparently, the rumour on the street is that he was kind of finding the joke quite funny until he looked at his wife, who had, pulled her hair out of the whole thing. Oh!
Yeah.
Like, don't lose your hair about it.
I like Jada Pinkett Smith. I thought she was very good in Gotham. She played Fish Mooney, didn't she?
She did, yeah.
I saw Collateral again for the first time in years. A couple of weeks ago, she's in that.
I like to call that film Cholesterol.
All right, so what do we think? Has it fucked up his career, or will he bounce back?
Yeah, he'll bounce back. I don't think Hollywood is terribly... doesn't really do punishment for very long.
It wasn't a punch. It was just a slap.
It was a slap, yeah. Which I think there is that element of, yes, he wasn't thinking. Yes, it was a reaction. Yes, there's obviously a whole load of stuff going on under the surface. But he walked up to The Rock and he slapped him rather than punched him.
Hold on, let's not confuse our audience. It wasn't The Rock, was it?
No, it wasn't The Rock. It was Chris Rock.
Right, yes.
The comedian. Good point. Yeah, because it would be understandable if he slowly walked up and slapped Chris The Rock. Yeah.
He's so nice, though, he wouldn't have done anything, even though he could have killed him.
He wouldn't have made that joke. Yeah, he wouldn't have made that joke.
Look, people have to make jokes.
Yeah, that's their, you know, and it's always going to be someone's going to be the butt of it, aren't they?
So get over it, Will. Yeah, naughty Will. Yeah. Great. All right, then. I've got a bit of sad news for you all. Have you all heard about the news about Bruce Willis?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
He is never going to act again.
Yeah, he's gone all jazzy, isn't he?
He's so guilty, he's got no... What has he got? Not got.
Aphasia.
No, but that means he hasn't got many cognitive abilities.
Yeah. Did you also see that Rotten Tomatoes awarded him his own category, like the worst of being Bruce Willis type thing this year? And then his diagnosis came out and they went, we are going to rescind that because that's not fair. And in hindsight, they also then have rescinded Shelley Duvall's nomination for The Shining.
You can't just rescind things.
Because they're saying, they're basically saying... it wasn't her fault. She was under such psychological pressure and mental pressure from Stanley Kubrick that her performance was not, because she's a bad actress.
I like her. I liked her performance.
Her performance is fantastic.
She's supposed to annoy the fuck out of Jack Nicholson, isn't she?
Well, saying what they did, they've rescinded that nomination as well because they're saying it's not a poor performance. It was a performance inspired aggressive and bullying.
I think we should ban Rotten Tomatoes because I don't really give a fuck about them anyway. I don't even know who these people are.
Yeah,
maybe it's not Rotten Tomatoes. What's the
the raspberries?
The Razzies. That was not the Rotten Tomatoes.
Well, that's
the Razzies.
Even worse. Oh dear.
But yeah, Willis made like 7 films last year.
Well, he's trying to get them all in before his cognitive failure, I guess.
It's a shame.
It's a shame. Very sad indeed.
He's supposed to be a bit of a bellend, though, right? But I do feel for him.
Yeah, I agree. Did you hear these things? Yeah, I've not warmed to him for many, many years.
I was all up his gear when it was like Return of Bruno, Moonlight, and Die Hard came out. I was like, really, really loved him to pieces. But then Hudson Hawk as well. That was good fun.
What about Pulp Fiction?
Pulp Fiction. That was kind of the Renaissance. Really good.
Well, I don't think it was the Renaissance. Hold on, it wasn't the Renaissance for Bruce Willis, was it?
Well, it was a little bit.
It wasn't.
John Travolta.
It was a Renaissance for John Travolta.
Oh, okay. I do take your point. I felt he was getting a bit dusty, but then did he?
Okay, okay. Well, there we go. Goodbye, Bruce.
That's it.
And what? Oh, I've got some more news. Blimey. Guess which film is 50 years old this year?
It's going to be
What were you going to say, Wood?
Loads of them.
Exactly 50. A Clockwork Orange is 50.
Oh, right.
Is it really?
Yes.
Can I Can I say I've never seen...
What?
There we go. Make note of that.
Right, yeah. Well, you'll be able to squeeze that one in next month. Laurie, what was the category again? Video Nasties. It is a video nasty.
Ooh, it's a video nasty.
It was a band, famously banned. So, yeah. Well, that's one choice then. Great. Anyone got anything else?
Got a little bit. The director of two really... Robert Eggers, right? So Robert Eggers, he gave us The Witch. Really good film. The Lighthouse. Exceptionally good film. Now, he is teaming up with Willem Dafoe again, and they're going to do Nosferatu. They're working on Nosferatu. Oh. So I know Willem Dafoe's done the Nosferatu character before in... I can't remember the name of the film. It's kind of sort of like a weird parody that it's got John Malkovich in it. But that was good fun. But it seems like this one's going to be a serious, moody, dark Nosferatu telling. So I'm quite looking forward to that.
Well, he's a very, very talented man.
Mm.
Which it's exactly, is that everything?
I think Nick Cage is doing a Dracula film as well at the moment.
Oh, yeah, he is.
Somewhere in the UK.
No one can take him seriously, apparently. And all I can keep thinking about is that bloody film, Vampire's Kiss.
Yeah, it's because Vampire's Kiss is so good.
Well, I think I really misjudged it.
I think you did.
Anyway,
you seen it again, or is this just on reflection?
On reflection.
You're making it better in your mind than it was on the screen.
A few times that you taught me around. Well, I think I completely missed the point of it.
It's an exceptionally good film. I mean, like, American Psycho has a lot in debt to that film, I believe. But that,
Right, so that brings me quite neatly onto In the Beam. I'll go first because it will fit into my segue. Nice. So talking of, what was it? Oh, I've forgotten his name now because I've been talking for too long. Willem Dafoe?
Yeah.
Mm.
He was in the film that I'm going to put in the bin, which is Spider-Man No Way Home.
Oh, right. You like that?
Yeah, I did.
Dafoe in that stupid cocking mask. They didn't cover up his beautiful goblin face with a mask, did they?
I'm not going to give away the spoilers that he's in it or not, because nobody knows if you haven't seen it. I was a massive big fan when I was a kid of Spider-Man, and my favourite villain was Green Goblin, and I was very
terrifying.
Very disappointed with the whole kind of first outtake of him, but they remain, it's the same character, same costume and everything like that, but they get away with getting rid of the mask very quickly, and he's got a purple hoodie on as well, so he looks a lot more like, it's using his face, which is obviously the best.
Brilliant.
Have you seen it, Wyndham?
I have, yeah, it's great.
Yeah, it's very long, but it's very perfect.
It's really well done. And it kind of cemented my deep appreciation and love for Tom Holland and Zendaya.
Who now? It's that Spider-Man and his girlfriend. And the fat one, don't forget him.
No, I don't care about him. It's really all about the Tom and Zendaya. And I'm not even talking about the characters, I'm talking about them.
Ooh. My favourite character, which was in the trailer, so I can't talk about it, was by far, I think, Dr. Octopus.
Is that because he's you?
No. But
you kind of forget
about
him.
All the best lines. He's got all the best lines. And,
I love Doc Ock.
Yeah.
He's great.
It's very clever what they did. They stuck Benedict Cumberbatch in it, but never mind.
He's a bit of a drain as well now, isn't he? I really liked him when he was doing stuff like Sherlock and things like that. And
you know what, Benedict? Less is more.
Yeah.
I like him and his beaver face.
Have you seen his Oscar nominated one?
The name of the dog or something.
The Wonder Dog.
My better half watched it and I was kind of laying on the sofa going, And it is good. I mean, the story that it tells, in a man's world, and he plays like a man, but he's a gay man.
I thought I thought it was Channing Tatum with the dog.
Huh?
What
film are we talking about?
I think Name of the Dog or something like that, where he plays a cowboy. He's a gay cowboy.
Is it not about Channing Tatum with a dog?
No, I don't think so. I don't
the power of the dog.
Yeah, and that's what we're talking about, isn't it? Channing Tatum is with a dog. No,
I don't know who Channing Tatum is.
Well, I don't really, but so we can't talk. But well, I know he's an actor.
I don't really know who he is.
I don't think he's in this film though. He's not.
Oh, we're so good at our
Kirsten Dunst, just fans. Yeah.
I haven't had time to see
anyway,
any of the Oscar
yes,
films.
I think it is a good film. And I think, you know, it's a very emotionally intelligent. Yeah, I think you should watch it.
Is it a career best for old Cumberbatch?
He's good in it. I'll give him that.
Is he as good as he was in The Wrath of Khan?
Oh, no, see, no, I haven't seen that. Does he play Khan?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a bit stupid.
Ricardo Montalban. I mean, how...
And instead of... Who says... It's someone else shouts, Carve! Don't they?
Do they? Yeah. Does he do Buried Alive?
No, he doesn't.
He's English.
Which, frankly, is...
Yeah.
Is a great disappointment.
He's not a superhuman either.
For the last,
oh, no,
I will grapple with thee. Oh, it's so good.
So good.
A Botany Bay. But
you've got to get that in. Was that a video nasty?
No, afraid not really.
Those SETI eels in the ears were pretty unpleasant.
It's pretty nasty.
Yeah, it was. I think that was the best Star Trek film.
I'm going to have to agree.
One with the whales was pretty good.
Oh, the one with the whales, so good.
Right, if we're talking about Oscars, I'm going to squeeze another one in. I watched The Eyes of Tammy Faye the other day.
Yeah.
Anyone seen it?
Nope.
Right, well, I heard this source of mine, though, is obviously not very reliable, but I heard quite bad things about this film, and I really enjoyed it. It's about a couple. One of them used to play Spider-Man.
Andrew Garfield.
And I can't remember who the woman is, but basically they play...
Jessica Chastain. She won an Oscar.
Not for makeup, wasn't it? Or did she win it for her acting?
Is she an impenetrable and a makeup underwear artist?
Okay. Anyway, she's very good. She plays a TV evangelist, her and Andrew Garfield, her husband. And it just shows her rise from the 50s all the way through to the 80s. And then obviously the husband was like, they were making millions and they had their own satellite and he was just stealing it, spending it on all this kind of stuff. And she had her eyes tattooed on. But she remained positive the whole time because she loved Jesus. There we go.
We got a handwritten invitation to praise Jesus' death through
Easter 2.
From a local Jehovah's Witness chapter. Handwritten, like full.
Oh, they like to mess with you,
full page of A4.
Those guys. Because if you asked anyone, they would think that they don't celebrate anything about Jesus, but they do. They're all over him, except for his birthday.
Right. Well, we politely have declined, but
you should go.
Yeah, we're not going to.
We'll do anything to get to be your friend. Hey, you might. All right. Who's got something then for In the Bean?
I don't this month.
Yeah, me as well.
You haven't got anything.
I've been racking my brain
like 2 months.
I could just easily just chuck a few of my love in here.
It's not the point of this picture.
Yeah.
No, we're going to have to go with your two, James.
Great. Well, my two are by far the best choice.
I was going to say, the quality remains high.
Okay, so let's move on the Rocks. I'm going to go first again.
Love on the Rocks. Ain't no surprise.
And I am going to put in the film that is known as Nightmare Alley. Anyone seen that?
No.
It's about it's set in a freak show circus. It's by the guy who did Shape of Water and Pan's Labyrinth.
Guillermo del Toro.
I cannot say that. And it is
it's got a good cast, though, isn't it?
It may have a good cast, but it's a very bland story, very obvious, and there is basically a kind of big smoking gun plot point very early on, and you cannot avoid just going, well, I know what exactly is going to happen in the rest of the film now, and I was right. And I was right. Yeah, it's very disappointing.
That is a shame. Because it's got Bradley Cooper, Kate Blanchett, Toni Collette, Willem Dafoe, Richard Jenkins, Rooney Mara, Ron Perlman.
Yeah, I saw all of those people.
Goodness me.
Yeah, but unfortunately, it just doesn't go anywhere.
Not forgetting Jim Beaver.
Oh, good old Jim.
His beaver.
Yeah. So
it's a profoundly obvious plot point. It's not because you're just a sound genius of plot and
writing. Right. Well, we'll see when you watch it, because it's worth watching. I mean, visually it looks brilliant. There's such a wealth of things they could do with a freak show, and they just didn't do anything that was interesting. But yeah, I think it's pretty damn obvious.
Right. Is it also a musical like The Great Showman?
Did he direct that?
No.
Oh.
But that's about a freak show as well, right? A bit.
Well, I think they're just
exploitation. Yeah, this is me.
Was Barnum a freak show, Barnum?
Well, in The Great Showman, there's a bearded lady and a wolf boy and a
little tiny fella.
And a very tall fella. And a
I am not sure how faithful that film is to the Barnum story, really.
This film is actually worth a watch. So I'll pop down to the rocks, fish it out, give it a check.
Well, yeah. Well, just to see if you can spot the smoking gun.
Okay, might be a bit wet down there, but yeah, I think it's fine.
And it's nothing to do with Toni Collette masturbating him in the bath.
Oh, okay.
That's just a little extra. She's very good, isn't she?
That's great. Yeah.
She is good. There's like a TV series thing that's going on that I think they're watching down in the. In the basement.
Yeah, they don't have pieces.
She is in something a bit shit.
They don't take it seriously. I watched that whole series in one night.
Really?
One night.
Mm.
Yeah. Well, there you go.
Well, you just need to go down the lift. They need to boat in all sorts of shit.
Yeah, we don't have a
pass. Severus.
All right, come on then. Who has got something from the rocks?
So I've got something on the rocks that I've just been reminded of, which would never normally feature in this podcast, but since you've mentioned Toni Collette and that she's very good, this is an example of something she was in that was extraordinarily bad, and I can't imagine why anybody would ever consider watching it, but
wow.
If they did, don't. It is 2017's epic masterpiece, XXX, Return of Xander Cage.
Who the fuck is Xander Cage?
Zin Diesel. They basically kind of, the first one was made at a point when extreme sports were kind of breaking on into the mainstream, and everybody was like, oh my God, that's amazing. People can like windsurf and rollerblade. And so they came up with a secret agent theory of like, well, actually he's an extreme sports person and he's a secret agent.
Is this the one where he had fucking silver eyes?
No, that's Pitch Black.
Because that got a sequel, didn't it?
Yeah, it's got two sequels. But this one is the only reason it even sticks in my head is because when Louise and I, we flipped onto it and Toni Collette came up and it was like, what? Jesus, big tax bill that year, love. Fuck it.
I have to be honest and say, until I saw this series and this film, I had no idea who this woman was.
What? She was in... What was that horror film we went to see?
Hereditary.
I now know this.
Muriel's Wedding.
Sixth Sense. Go through the films looking for the celebrities.
Such a bell.
Anyway, so that's
a massive bell.
She was in About a Boy, Little Miss Sunshine.
I've seen one of those films.
Little Miss Sunshine's good.
Yeah, I've seen it. I haven't seen About a Boy. Is that the one about the record shop?
No.
That's the one with, what's his name? She plays a kind of depressive mother.
Which is the one upset in the record shop?
Tom Holt, is it? Timothy
Holt? Same author.
They're all in a van, they go off for a dance competition. Granddad's in there, everybody's in there. Uncle's in there,
that's
a lot.
That's Little Miss Happiness.
Oh, shut up.
That's Little Miss Sunshine, yeah.
Yeah, that's the one.
Yeah. I haven't got anything for the rocks apart from you, James.
Stop very nice.
Out.
Right. Well,
actually, so can I just, when you were leaning back there, Laurie, you looked a little bit like the current incarnation of Mel Gibson.
Man, I'm doing well.
Yeah, I'm
doing good. Shit.
Well, that brings us on to the trailer trawler. And I am very excited to say the trailer trawler is brimming with probably the best trailer that's ever been made in the creation of cinema. And that is for the biopic of the Elvis film coming out in June.
Oh,
and we're going to get to listen to it right now.
There are some who'd make me out to be the villain of this here story.
Just don't let a good thing die.
Are you born with destiny? Or does it just come knocking at your door?
He's a young singer from Memphis, Tennessee. Give him a warm hayride welcome. Mr. Elvis Presley.
Get a haircut, buttercup.
In that moment, I watched that skinny boy transform into a superhero.
Because it's that good. I haven't seen this trailer about 73 times.
Oh, fantastic. I haven't seen it once. Are you excited?
Oh, it's excited? Amazing. Yeah. I think, what's his name? You see, I'm not very good with actors' names.
Tom Hanks.
Yes. He plays the Colonel in it. And it's quite an interesting performance because obviously, if you know anything about Elvis, the Colonel was very controlling in his career. But you could then argue to say it was thanks to the Colonel that he became so famous.
Hmm. And is it the telling of it's that story? It's about the Colonel and Elvis, is it?
I think, yeah. Well, I haven't seen it yet, but yes, I imagine so.
What's it called?
Elvis, isn't it? I don't know.
71 times he's watched the trailer.
Doesn't say.
Are you getting all a bit Bruce? Keep your eye on him, Wynn.
It doesn't have that guy who says, this time, Elvis faces his darkest threat. What's it called? It is called Elvis.
It is called Elvis, yeah.
Thank you. And it's made by the guy who did Moulin Rouge.
Baz Luhrmann.
Well,
oh, right. Crikey. Yeah. Well, he's very stylistic.
Well, it's a very stylistic film.
Yeah. Well, he's like comedic and...
There's a dude in it called Cody Smit McPhee.
What now?
There's a guy in it called Cody Smit McPhee.
Who do they play?
They play Jimmy Rogers.
Who the fuck's Jimmy Rogers?
Don't know. But what's his name? Cody's bringing it to life.
They'll be interested to see how much Priscilla squeezes herself into this film as well, because I think she's quite controlling over the whole thing.
Right.
By Olivia de Jong.
Yeah. Apparently she went and hugged the actor who's playing Elvis and went, yes, you're just right, or something.
Mm.
Do you mean the actresses or her incarnation of Priscilla is?
No, the real Priscilla hugged the actor playing Elvis and basically said, oh yeah, it's like looking in a mirror, which it isn't. And also, you wouldn't know anyway.
No, wouldn't be.
She was only with him for
like looking in the mirror.
2 years.
You look like somebody completely different.
You know, I really liked her until I went to see her in Panto. She was fucking awful. Oh. I mean, and you have to be pretty bad to be bad in Panto anyway. I mean, she was just... I mean, it was unbelievably bad. She was quite...
There's a lot of leeway for shonky performances in Panto, isn't
it? Yeah, but if you think about how she was in Naked Gun, which was quite a reasonable performance. I rewatched that the other day. And then, you know, it was awful.
Yeah.
Right. So that's all the news and all the things, all the
features. Oh, no. I saw a trailer. There's a thing called You Won't Be Alone. This is another one of these kind of like set in the oldie worldy days when we're living in nature and little huts and stuff like that. Kind of like the witch kind of vibe. You Won't Be Alone by a guy called Gorgon
Zola.
Goran Stilevski. Probably Goran, isn't it?
There you go.
What's it about?
Noomi Rapace.
It's rather good. I think it may be another bloody vampire telling.
Oh, you're obsessed with vampires.
I know, I've got a vampire problem. But this isn't my kind of favourite vampire.
It's a witch.
Okay, that's fine. Better. Good.
Have you watched the series or the film of What We Do in the Shadows?
What's the beginning of it? The American one. New Zealand one, whatever Kiwi it is.
One, the original.
I watched all of that. Yeah. But now the BBC have done a re.
With America. Hello. The series is very, very good indeed.
Well, the BBC one?
Yeah, it's very funny.
Oh, right. Okay, I need to pick it up again.
But the original movie's really great.
The original movie's great. I don't know what else to say.
It's the Flight of the Conchords, people, isn't it? Taika Waititi's in it.
He's not in Flight of the Conchords.
I don't mean for that then, but he's in.
He's in. Jermaine's there.
I think you'll find Taika Waititi or whatever his name is isn't in this film. He just made the original.
He's not.
It's not in the series. It's different actors.
Oh no! He's not. I was talking about the film.
Although he is in the series, but not playing that character.
Yeah.
Somebody else.
Well, he's so versatile, isn't he? He's got a film about pirates coming out. The story of a gentleman pirate. Have you heard about this?
Ugh.
It's literally apparently it's a true story. This lord, British lord, had all the money, all the houses, all this, that, and the other. And one day he decided he wanted to be a pirate. So he went and bought a ship as opposed to stealing one, which would be very pirate-like. He then paid his sailors, his pirate crew, a salary as opposed to plundering stuff.
Very apparently reasonable.
He was a very bad pirate.
Wow. It reminds me of the 40s film, The Wicked Lady. Anyone seen that film?
No.
A wicked lady. Yeah, it's about an aristocratic woman who's a bit of a cunt by all stretch of imagination. And after she's stolen her best friend's husband, or betrothed husband, her fiancé, and gets married to him, she then finds a secret passage in her bedroom which leads to a set of highwayman clothes, so she becomes a highway robber.
Nice.
I love it. Very good indeed.
Mm.
Right. Shall we carry on and get on with this then?
Yes.
So let's get on with our feature, which is going all the way back to 2009. Do you both remember 2009?
No. What would I have been, 29?
No way, you're older than that.
13 years ago. Fuck, I am. I am older than that.
Yeah.
For a second there, I thought I was 42. I'm not. I'm 46.
You're not?
No. Yeah.
2009, my wife was saying, Laurie, stop drinking. I need your semen.
Why does she need your semen to drink?
I don't know. It's a singing voice thing. She couldn't get the top C or something.
I'll be talking to her about that.
So it's 13 years ago. I would have been 33.
You're still trying to work.
Yeah, I'm trying to place myself.
It wasn't a medical year.
I was working in Richmond, is what was happening.
I'll get on to tell you what was going on in the world. So here's some information about 2009. It was the year that swine flu raised its ugly head and then just kind of went away again. It didn't seem to affect anyone except the pigs.
Aptly named them.
Yeah. It was a year of the MP expenses scandal. Do you remember?
Oh, God. Is this moats and birdhouses?
That was it. It was
duck houses. Yeah. What's duck houses?
Yeah.
What a bunch of twats.
Anyway, they've pulled themselves together since then, thankfully.
Thank God for that.
In popular culture, we had the worst snowfall in 20 years.
Or the best, depending which way you look at it. It was fantastic. I remember my socks on that day.
On TV, can you imagine what we had on TV? Britain's Got Talent, The X Factor, EastEnders, Coronation Street, Dancing on Ice. A fucking awful year for television. that went on for about 10 years, all that shit, didn't it? Were you fans?
No.
Well, I kind of liked The X Factor.
To begin with, X Factor was all right.
Yeah.
Only for the first 2 or 3 years.
You suddenly woke up like in the Matrix. Like, what am I doing?
Yeah.
What do you think the best selling album of the year was?
Coldplay.
Thankfully not. It was Susan Boyle with the best selling album of the year. That dream, the dream.
Oh, bless her. She dreamed that dream, goddammit. Yeah. Bless her.
What's she up to these days, I wonder?
She's skiing. She's off still a couple doing of that Ethiopians.
I think she's still touring her Dream a Dream and listen to my pipes.
Well, it was a good year for celebrity deaths, though, so that might lift our mood a little bit. I'm gonna go in reverse order.
What, right, of how so happy you are about it?
From one five, we care.
In fifth place, it was Molly Sugden.
There goes Molly.
Wow.
Yeah. In fourth place, it was Tony Hart.
Oh, crap. Oh. See? Oh, man.
In third place, it was Patrick Swayze.
Oh, Lord Patrick Swayze.
Oh,
in second place, it was Michael Jackson.
Wow. Oh. Heavy.
Yeah. And in first place, it was, of course, Jane Goodall.
Oh, my God.
It really was the year of celebrity, wasn't it?
That's it. We know a song about that one, didn't we?
Yeah. Well, that's not advertised. I'm afraid not.
Some awesome playwright. Playwright and lyricist.
Right. Top five grossing films. Anyone want to have a guess?
Oh, I can't place the time.
Yeah, the kind of wash over you films, really. Avatar, which we've got another 6 of them to come, so that'll be fun.
Yeah.
The Half-Blood Prince, so we're in the pot. Franchise.
Yeah.
Ice Age Dawn of the Dinosaurs.
Oh, God.
Good bit of alliteration there, but I think that was all. Up, which was okay.
Yeah, it was good.
But not practically possible.
No.
And then the Oscar winner, which everyone went on about for ages, which I thought was a bit boring, really, which was Slumdog Millionaire, which again was
I haven't seen that either.
All right, well, there we go. So let's hope the films are a little better. Probably not. So let's start with District 9. Before we go any further, let's have a little clip.
Nobody comes back late at night anymore. They have more security.
The government noticed that they were moving into new areas. That's when things started to get out of hand.
They don't belong here.
They're spending so much money to keep them here when they could be spending it on other things. At least they're keeping them separate from us.
A lot of bad things started to happen.
They must just go. I don't know where they go. And they must just go.
We're at the breaking point. People are living in fear.
So obviously it was released in 2009. It was the director. Right, I thought this was a Peter Jackson film.
So yeah, he's producer. He's involved as producer, yeah.
Oh, right, okay. So the director was Neil Blomkamp. And the author was Neil Blomkamp.
I think he's just Blomkamp.
Where's he from?
South Africa.
Okay. Alive.
You're not a big fan of South Africa, James.
I'm impartial. Right, it's for the book Alive in Joburg by Neil Blomkamp. Screenplay Terry Tatchell and Neil Blomkamp. Music Clinton Shorter. The budget was $30 million and it made $210 million at the box office. And Rotten Tomatoes gave it 9%. Notable actors. Well, Charlton Copley, who played our protagonist, really, Wilkes.
Vicus van der Merwe.
That's the one. Oh, yeah, well remembered. And then, I'm not going to go through the others.
They're all South African actors, aren't they? They're not.
Yeah, no one really stood out. Okay, so, come on. Wyndham.
Yeah.
Had you seen this film before?
I had, yes.
And what do you think of it?
I really like this film.
Right.
Yeah, and I liked it the first time I saw it. It put me onto Neil Blomkamp. Has got a a little production studio that makes these quite heavy effects laden stuff. But I think given the relatively small budget, I think the look and feel of it is brilliant. And I love fact that it is, you know, it's not subtle in its, you know, drawing comparisons with South Africa as it is and the apartheid in South Africa. And just the story it tells of, you know, the society we live in, nobody wants to be the bottom rung. So you just want to get off that bottom rung and have somebody to look down on and you know, have power over. I think it's a great film. And I really like Sharlto Copley, certainly in this. He plays Howling Mad Murdoch in the 18 movies, which people are probably more aware of him.
How many 18 movies have there been?
11.
Yeah, 11. And he was also in Elysium with Jodie Foster and Matt Damon. He plays a
hard nut in that, though, doesn't he? Yeah,
like an agent in that. But I think he's great. And I think he's brilliant in this.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I didn't ask you that, but thank you anyway.
You didn't. Yeah, you're welcome.
You asked me what I thought. Also, it must play into your, you know, your love of RoboCop and that whole Van. Oh damn it! What's his name? Van Hooven. He's kind of, you know, that kind of multimedia kind of thing where the documentary meets a newsflash meets real time.
That's not why Wyndham likes RoboCop.
The goriness.
Right, come on. Had you seen it before, Laurie?
I had seen it before and I was very impressed. I mean,
the second time round?
Yes, yeah, first time round and even second, third, fourth, fifth. I mean, this is probably the only second time I've actually sat down and watched it, but again, or from beginning to middle to end. It's one of those films that, like, if you bump on into it on the TV, no matter where you are, it can kind of suck you in. So I've seen this film, you know, I've met it in the middle and watched it through to the end because, yes, it's very engrossing and very, very well done.
Well, I'd never seen it before. I had it, someone bought it.
Wow.
And it must have been Christmas 2009 on DVD and it sat there on my shelf for all that time. And then I couldn't find it, so I had to just get it and stream it in the end.
Wow.
I had kind of low expectations of it, really. I'm kind of, I think it was because I thought Peter Jackson had done it.
And, right.
He's just annoyed the hell out of me these days with his Hobbits and his Lord of the Rings.
Well, yeah, so you couldn't have expected what you got at all then, right?
Well, more or less.
Oh, really?
Well, I thought it was going to be like kind of up itself and a bit knowing, which it was. I didn't think much of the alien design. But what I wasn't going to expect is that actor who played the South African, who is in the main part of the film, the protagonist, was brilliant.
Yeah,
he was. And it just pulled me in. And I thought it was quite annoying at first, but very quickly forgotten about how annoying he was and loved the film.
Yeah, well, honestly, I think that's quite interesting. You know, when it first came out, I think it was really quite, very fresh, quite original. I can't really think of anything I've seen like that.
Right, stop. Right, I'll tell you what I didn't like the film. It's been so long since I watched it. But there's a really very clear reason why this film does not work whatsoever. Who knows what this is?
I think it does work, so evidently I've missed it.
So you've missed it. Laurie?
Is it... I'm trying to think.
All right, so what is the style of this film?
Kind of sort of documentary.
It's a documentary, isn't it? Fire the Wall documentary. For about half the film, and then they're all about it, and they're just
with
it, except when they remember to do it. You can't do that. It's just... one minute you've got them doing the documentary, and then suddenly the camera is wherever it is in like a cinematic way.
Yeah, but just because you're getting all the perspectives. No, you're the viewer, you're God.
It's not establishing that. It does need to, because it makes a farce of the whole thing.
It does not set itself up as this is found footage.
Of course it does. It's not really. So what? That opening scene where he's introducing it and saying, "Oh, you know, someone's messing about behind him and all this kind of stuff."
My wife's little angel.
Yeah, it's only when the shots get more difficult at the end, and I think they just get bored of doing it. So it kind of ruined the whole film for me.
It is a fair point.
Well, it changes from that approach when you start seeing the aliens' perspective. So when the main alien, Chris, I think he's called, Chris Johnson.
Christopher.
When he's talking to the other adult alien and the son.
Yeah.
And you're getting the backstory that actually what we've been told by the human perspective is these are stupid. They're animals. They're this, that, and the other. And then we finally get this shot that kind of goes, actually, they built a fucking spaceship, right? So they can't be that stupid. And we just get this different perspective. And I agree with Laura. You don't need... It's not the Blair Witch Project. It's a different approach.
But there are scenes where they're just cutting it in between. It does not... Well, for me, it didn't work. Also, why would you have that be that technologically advanced and then come all the way to Earth and leave your spaceship up there?
Yeah, but it never tries to explain any of that. Even at the end when Christopher does that whole kind of, okay, it's gonna be 3 years because I've got to go home and come back.
I thought it was five years.
No, it's three. But you're right, it does sit there kind of going, why did they come? Why did they stop?
Yeah.
What's going on? It doesn't care about that. It doesn't matter. We're not interested in that. We're interested in almost the kind of what happens to us.
Just to quickly frame this, though,
if there's any listener out there that hasn't seen this already, I suspect most people have seen this, but it could be the odd person that hasn't.
You're
in Johannesburg, and then this big, like, alien ship turns up over Joburg.
Sorry, because of the change of format, we've axed this bit.
Oh, yeah.
Go on.
Honestly, I was getting so bad.
Go on.
So anyway, this big alien ship turns up over Joburg. Humanity are all excited about it. They go up there, they manage to drill in, and then they just find all these kind of really hungry and sick aliens that look a little bit like prawns. So they kind of call them that name. Anyway, they come down.
Well, we can use the word prawn. It's not offensive.
Well, I feel bad saying it. But anyway, so then they set up this camp and it's all, you know, they've got like the human statue of a human touching the hand of a prawn. And it's all beautiful, but then quite quickly it just all goes to shit because they need to be fed. They need medicines and stuff like that. So basically where they're living, all these prawns turns into a slum. And then you really get into that sort of culture of, you know, how they survive.
It does portray the country as quite a racist country, doesn't it, towards
South Africa.
Well, I don't say it, but yeah.
The apartheid-ridden South Africa might be a bit racist.
It does suggest that.
Yeah, very, very strongly it suggests that.
But it sets it up really well. There's a real veracity to its kind of realness, as it were. Which is wonderful. And at the beginning of the film is basically what they're going to do. They're sick of this slum now. They just want it away from Joburg. Humanity, they want to just piss off kind of things. They want to stick them in a concentration camp like 200 kilometres away or whatever. And that's where this guy is going into a victim, basically.
It's lucky they didn't land in Australia because they may have put them on like huge barbecues.
You'd need for them suckers, right?
What do we think of the acting? I thought it was all over the place. Some people were very good, some people weren't.
I think it's superb.
Yeah.
Absolutely right, though. You do get lots of different... It's kind of a camp comedic kind of comedy to all of the characters, really. I mean, the baddie dad, the
wife...
But
some are better at it than others, I would suggest. It's not consistent, really.
Yeah.
Yeah, the most important performance is Vicus van der Merwe, played by Sholto Copley, and he absolutely nails it.
Yeah, he really does. Yeah, absolutely.
Because all these others are a little bit stereotypical. So when they're trying to clear the slum, the government employ a private contractor called MNU, who are a weapons manufacturer, and they've discovered that these aliens have weapons, but humans can't fire them. So there's this whole load of research division going on to try to figure that out.
Yeah.
So the story essentially talks to lots of things about racism, capitalism, neoliberalism, division, militarization. You know, it talks about South Africa.
Yeah.
Essentially, you know, it isn't just hinting at the racist nature of South Africa. It's going, ta-da, this is it. But it's also talking about human nature, which is that nobody wants to be the bottom rung. And if you divide people enough, we punch down rather than punching up. And that's all they're saying. That is what this film is saying. But it doesn't matter where we are societally. It doesn't matter what happens. We are on a ladder. And if you're at the bottom of the ladder, then you're in shit.
And on that point, actually, that's a very, very unique thing about this film, because I can't think of a sci-fi alien film where they play literally, you know, third, fourth class to human. You know, they're right at the bottom. I was trying to crack my brain. It's like, E.T.? No, because he turned up with his glowing heart and all-healing finger and
what about the time
rose again. Wait a minute. E.T., that's the story of Jesus kind of thing, isn't it, really, if you think about it?
Most anyway, the story of Jesus, apparently.
But are there any other alien films where they play the lowest of the low?
The Time Traveller?
Have you just duped me?
No, the Baldar. The Baldar, they're the kind of lowest species, aren't they, I guess?
Oh, right. You're probably more versed at this.
Oh, the Malocs.
That's the one.
Malocs?
Yeah.
The time machine you're talking about, right?
That's what I said, no, nearly. What did I say?
You said the time travel.
Well.
well done, you.
Maybe. 10 points. Maybe, but you're right. It's that works very well. Again, I hate to say it, but what doesn't work, right, so the alien design is brilliant.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
However,
design is brilliant.
If you were to become infected and suddenly turn into an alien, it wouldn't just do that bit of your arm.
It wouldn't start at the extremities and work
in. Exactly. None of that makes sense.
It would be more Brundlefly.
You're sounding like Wyndham and his love arc problem. Leave it.
These are all the things that really irritated me.
Don't be a bell. It does not affect the film. Actually, it's fine. Of course it does. It allows the film to work, okay? And the metamorphosis stuff is really great.
All right, well, go on. It's
very much like The Fly in a way.
No, it's not. The Fly does it brilliantly and slowly and methodically, and, you know.
No, it does it fine. When his eye goes all a bit big near the end, it looks great.
What do you think?
So I take your point, and because I really love the film, it doesn't bother me at all.
But you will affect.
I get your point. No, because I love the film, and that always biases our scoring. You know that. I don't have a problem with it. I do get what you're saying, but I don't have a problem with it.
I like the way that they time the film as well. So you've got like 13 hours after exposure.
Yeah.
36 hours after exposure. I like that. I like that kind of pacing of the film. And I think there's a real pickup when the little kid of Christopher, I think he wakes up the mothership or something like that. Something happens to the film where it really kind of ups the ante near the end. Because I think there might be a little lag halfway.
Did the alien call his son Christopher after himself?
No.
I don't know. I don't know.
The humans called all of the aliens human names.
Right.
But the adult
alien you said was called Christopher, yes?
Yes, Christopher Johnson.
Was the son called Christopher as well?
No.
Right, okay.
There are.
What about the music, Laurie?
Music's good. Yeah.
There isn't any music.
Yes, there is.
Is there?
I'm sure there is. Is there not?
Tell me a bit with where the music is.
Shit.
You see, you are just seeing this through rose-coloured glasses.
Which, frankly, is not what this podcast is about.
Oh, all right. Yeah, well, Dave, it just wasn't for me. It's obviously very relevant. And, the allegory of the bigger picture is very interesting. But apart from that, I didn't like it very much. Sorry.
I did really like the kid alien. I mean, his tech savviness is amazing.
Yeah, well, he's wonderful.
It's taken everybody 20 years to get the chip activated, and he's hearing it, that's right, I'll reroute this, I'll do that, I'll change this, I'll get that to work, I'll send this message. It's great. Oh.
They were really well realized, weren't they? You got really got their, you know, kind of them in that situation, their culture. It's just, yes. I
mean, yeah, very, very yeah, they built the world incredibly well, really.
The thriftiness.
Right. So, what has anyone got any favourite scenes that they want to talk about? Standout moments? Or memorable lines?
When it first came out, I was really impressed of the shot of the mothership. And it's, you know, it's kind of not far in the background, but it's like, you know, the back of Joburg, and the shot, you've got the smog of the city going over the mothership. And I remember being very impressed by that.
I remember being very impressed when they did that in 1984 with V.
With V?
Yeah, they always have the mothership in the background, didn't they?
Yeah, but did it have a fantastic smog over it, like a real realness to it?
The smog in 1984.
There you go, that's it. And I think that was just one of those films where they start really understanding light and stuff like that. So yeah, the look of it.
Okie dokies.
Very impressive.
Wyndham?
So I quite like when I first watched it, and again this time, you know, his wife is throwing a party for his promotion, but it's after the raid. Yeah. So he's had the black stuff, and he comes in, the lights are all off. Do you go, what's going on? Darling, I think I've shit myself, and the lights come on. I might have shit myself, and the lights come on. And you just think, oh my God, I don't think I'd be that flight. I think I'd be, get out of the way.
I like it when he gets in the suit robot thing and just really starts kicking some ass.
That is a very good bit at the end. Yeah, I do like that very much. Thumbs up for me.
Oh, yeah. Good.
Right, should we score it then?
Yeah, let's do that.
Okay, so performances, I'd give it a 7.
8.
I've given it a 7.
Effects, Lauren.
9.
8.
8 for me. Plot, Wyndham.
8.
5.
Yeah, 8. 8.
Okay. Rewatch factor, Lauren.
That's a 7.
It's a 2.
It's a 5.
Direction, Wyndham.
8.
2.
7.
I had to knock a lot of points off because of the fact that they didn't get, you know. The
actually, no, sorry, I'm 8, 8, 8, 8, 8.
You can't, don't, like, 1.
I've done it.
Well, I've done it as well. So we get,
I misread
1
it.
For me.
Too shame, what I mean.
Right, cinematography, 5.
7.
It looked good.
8. Jesus.
Sound of music, Wyndham.
6.
6.
Oh. It has a great sound to it. Obviously, 2. That must have been a music to me. 7.
Originality, Wyndham.
8.
Laurie?
I suppose this has been told. 8.
4.
I'm scoring this very high.
You are, and you're going to be cross with your own score at the end of it.
Yeah, they'll probably put it above Jaws. All right. enjoyability, 3.
7.
7, because I did come to this, and obviously it took forever for me to watch these films, and I think it's the oppression, the control, the murder, the betrayal that this film depicts probably put me off. It probably put me off a little bit. But, yeah.
And life-changing, past or present, 1.
0.
Do you ever mark that higher than a 0?
I have done a handful of times.
Oh, right, okay, good, just checking.
I'm giving it a 3.
All right, so it gets a score of 38 from me.
Oh, that is low. Gets 64 from me.
And
Crikey.
Which gives us a Movie Lighthouse appreciation score of 58.3.
So, 58.3 in our 2022 leaderboard puts it in 4th place below Dr. Strangelove and the Evil Dead 2, but above the Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2, which I think is fair enough, really.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's certainly not better than The Evil Dead 2.
Fair.
Another rather larger scoreboard, which may I say takes me ages to change now.
Yes.
It's all right. 58.3.
Why does it take you ages to change?
I have to change all the numbers.
Why don't you do it in Excel and just...
Because I've never really liked Excel. I don't trust it.
Is that the thing that happens?
You can do everything better in Word.
Apart from automatically update numbers by just inserting a new line.
Well, it doesn't matter. Well, but what if there's three which get the same number?
There's a formula for that.
Yeah. It goes in... It goes in... 69. It's in reverse. 70. It plays 70th, which is just above Blood Feast. Haven't seen that for a while.
Oh, yeah.
And just below Possession and Quatermass and the Pit.
Oh, wow. We've covered some good films, man.
Have indeed.
Yeah.
Some mediocre films too. No, it was all right. But I didn't think it was great. Right, should we move on to the next feature?
Yeah.
Which is basically simply called Nine.
Wait. I'm a friend.
Are we alone?
No, no.
What's this?
I found him in the emptiness.
You lead the beast straight back to us.
Where did it come from? Why is it hunting us?
They've been lost in the past, looking for answers.
Science has turned against us. Join me in repelling the iron fist of the machine.
We awaken something.
Something terrible.
I think this is an abject lesson in Laurie breaking the rules.
Why? Why?
Because he proposed two films, neither of which fit the brief. So you said, tough shit, we're having both of Wyndham's.
Yeah, you did.
Yeah. I'm not
sad about that.
What films did you choose?
I can't remember. It's some old shit. Oh. I didn't really care for the...
Bam. This film, has anyone heard of this film before?
I had seen it before, yeah.
I'd heard of it, but I hadn't watched it.
Right, okay. All right, so it was released in 2009. The director was Shane Acker, a story by Shane Acker. The screenplay was by Pamela Pettier. The music was by Deborah Lurie. Is that right?
You just drop in the A. No one will know.
Budget was 20 million, it made 48.4 million, and it got 57% on Rotten Tomatoes. And Christopher Plummer played the scientist. Martin Landau, I've heard of him as well. He played someone. John C. Reilly, he played someone. Crispin Glover played someone. Jennifer Connelly played someone. Fred Tatasciand and Elijah Wood. Wow, it's an all-star cast.
There you go.
Or wouldn't it be better if we could have seen them?
No, absolutely not.
Right, what do we think of this film?
Because it's an animation, right? Rather than live action.
Yeah, well, so like I say, I haven't seen this before. It was on my radar. I think it got quite good critic reviews when it first came out, but I never got around to seeing it. And I thoroughly enjoyed it, really. You know, it's an odd, strange little film, bizarre film. But thoroughly enjoyed it. It's definitely one of those kind of like Sunday on the sofa kind of manoeuvres, I feel. Really pleased that I watched it. On a Thursday at 11 o'clock.
My problem with it, really, I guess, is who is the audience for this film?
Yes.
It's a good question, because it is, when I was watching it, I've got pretty dark stuff, because it's set in a post-apocalyptic world, essentially, where... humans have managed to destroy themselves by building technology that was supposed to protect them. But the technology, like all these films, realizes we're a bunch of twats and ends up eradicating us or being co-opted by humans. And so you have these kind of ragdolls almost that this creator, this human Geppetto style type person has created, and somehow they come to life, and the landscape they live in is there's no human life left. It's
everywhere. Literally first shots, one of the little soul sacks pokes his head into a car, and there's a little girl dead with her mother, and it's like, okay, this is not your normal now, animated kind of
shock. Can I just check? You named them. You just christened them that name, did you? Because it is a bit of a spoiler. I know we do spoilers anyway, but they're not called
soul sacks.
They're not called that, are they?
They're just called numbers. So there are nine of them.
Yeah.
But then, and then it goes on to kind of, as the story progresses, they end up discovering like footage and newspaper articles about the downfall of man, and you know, it's chemical warfare, it's gassing of people, it's very, very Nazi-istic. Yeah,
great for a cartoon.
Yeah, but it really put me in mind of, you know, whenever we've reviewed cartoons of our childhood, animations of our childhood in the 70s, they were full on.
When the wind brutal. Blows. That was the 80s.
All that kind of stuff. Yeah. Proper, we're not pulling our punches for the kids. So I agree, it's not entirely clear who the audience is. Yeah. But if it is for young people, then it's moving back to a time when a good kick in the balls for a kid was really what helped them grow up.
Yeah, I think we've answered it there. It's pretty much for everyone. With a parental guidance of above.
I'd be interested to see whether children or kids would like this film, though. I don't know if they would. I think one of the main problems is, and they didn't have to do this, is they named the characters numbers and they made them all look more or less exactly the same. So, there are subtle differences, but not, you know,
they're like a version of like Iron Man's suit.
Say again.
They have a big one to hold stuff up, and then you have a thin one to be the command one, and then you have some kind of droney ones.
Yeah.
You have the kick-ass one with like a skull helmet.
But I found I just didn't really care about the characters until about maybe halfway through. I wasn't really into the story at all, and then I got kind of sucked into it with the central mystery was quite good, and you know, what was going on and stuff. And it was a bit sad at the end. I thought they were all going to come back.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a bit of a strange ending, isn't it? But like I said,
the film
is very, very strange. I love the design of it. You basically, like you say, it's got that Second World War vibe going on with the kind of like Nazi, but it's kind of steampunk version of Second World War kind of deal. So the design's like really
Terminator,
great.
Well, it's Terminator 2, really, isn't it?
Well, it's that, and then it's got real essence of Matrix in it as well.
If Terminator...
Yeah. With
Terminator,
the Sentinels.
If the Terminator robots and the Sentinels wanted to go to the cinema after their apocalypse, this is maybe what they're going to see.
Well, the director, Shane Acker, I like the way you pronounce it, this was based on a short film that he'd already done, which was Nine. And I think it must have got really good reviews and stuff like that. So he made this. This is his label of love. And it's one of those ones, again, like, you know, when we're talking about Vampire's Kiss, you know, I thought that director of that must have gone on to great, amazing things. Same as this, because, you know, it's really unique, great look. I think it's put together really well. But no, not really. He's done a bit of animation on The Great and Powerful Oz. He did a bit of work on The Lord of the Rings. But really not a lot.
How do you direct a film? How does it work? Do you direct the actors? I don't have to direct the actors and stuff.
Excel spreadsheets and stuff. You wouldn't understand it, mate. I wouldn't even bother. But I'm quite proud of myself, actually. I love my animation, and you know, when I was little and all that. And they're the Quay brothers. Yeah, and they make this kind of really kind of gothic-y kind of, very much that kind of, you know...
What brothers?
The Quay brothers.
Is that like brothers. Finley Quay and his brother?
But they made these kind of like dark stop-motion stuff, you know, like the doll's head. It's definitely, it's a very recognised motif now.
Yeah,
I think
they
were one of the early ones where you had that kind of fucked up doll's head, sellotape to scissors and things like that. So obviously he's taken a lot from that into this, but no, I really liked it. But that that strangeness that we keep coming back to. It's like, what? It's a knitted doll walking around in a world that's...
Hessian sacks, aren't they?
What the fuck? And then the thing starts unfolding, you realise that the Geppetto character has put a little bit of his soul, like a Horcrux in a way, into all these like nine or however many sacks there are, a little bit of his soul to save humanity, because he knew that obviously the machines will get to that point where we're all screwed. So yeah, odd, but good. A little bit of Blade Runner, you know, that thriftiness, yeah. Again, you've got these little characters in there where they're going around making stuff from the stuff, as it were. So that's
just wish that been a little bit different. But I think if I watched it again, I think I'd like it even more.
Yeah, and even I've got the IMDb page up on my iPad, and it's just flicking through some of the scenes. And when it reflects back on the footage of when the machines took over, you've got like these two legged walkers, like in Star Wars.
Yeah.
Their design is more the artwork to the original War of the Worlds. So it's got these kind of layering in of kind of sci-fi history.
But then again, that stink of the Second World War.
Yeah.
That stink of the Nazis and their machines and that steampunkness. Really, really good.
Hmm.
I looked up the word soul sack because they're like, it comes off my tongue very easy. And I was like, what could it be? What's a soul sack? That's definitely something, isn't it? It's a thing. And I looked in the Urban Dictionary. It's basically when you're getting pulled over by the police, you hide your stash in your nuts, praying that you don't go to jail. So that's a soul sack.
Really?
Yeah. It's when you hide your stash in your nuts, bro.
Right. Well, I have a question for you. Because I think sometimes marketing is the key. What could they have called it, which could have changed the whole way people saw this film? Because 9 is a shit number. It's a shit number.
It's a shit name for a film, really.
Unless you're a cat.
I should have called it 7, and they would have come in their droves.
8. So the sequel to 7.
So come on, what else could you have called it? Soul Sacks. Oh, you're terrible at these questions.
Yeah. It's almost like you sprint. Go on, what would you call it?
Yeah, go on. What would you call
it? I'm asking the question.
Nothing nice, perfect. Come on, let's go with it. But yeah, no, it's really good. It's one of those little treats. So thank you, Windy Bum.
I wasn't sure why they were looking for this creature as well. Why were they looking for it?
I think turn it off.
He's driven 9, the last one to come to life.
Yeah. Like bagpipes.
Oh, I know why. I know why. Because they lost the kind of very magical thing, didn't they? The MacGyver, whatever it is.
Oh, yeah.
So they go and find the MacGyver and then accidentally wake up the big bastard who steals their soul, sucks their souls into his machine, and they're like, oh, let's try and save it. Because again, that was a strangeness, because I thought, oh, when the first soul gets sucked into it, I'm like, oh no, he just looks like a horrible monster, and it's just actually the dude in there going, no, it's okay, it's all right. Mm. And that was confusing me for a while, and then he eats the next soul, and I'm like, oh, actually, they really are kind of going in there. But you see the soul peeking out. It's like, well, surely they're controlling the machine then. But no, they're not. They're just basically giving him more fuel to be a bastard.
Bit like Freddy Krueger takes people's souls and they're hanging around in pizzas and stuff.
Exactly like that, you see.
And can I just offer a word of advice to anybody out there who is currently working on an all-powerful AI robot, anything that's going to help humanity? Please don't make the colour of its eye red. just don't.
Just go for a nice turquoise.
Yeah.
They're not red, but they've got red setting always, which is always a bit of a
problem. Yeah. Flip the switch on the back.
I think you can have films as scary as they want for kids and stuff like that, but you've got to have some humour in it. Like even with When the Wind Blows, you've got the guy's arse crack. You know, putting
down and stuff. You can hold on to that.
Flight of the Fireflies. There must have been some humour in that. Grave of the Fireflies.
I missed it.
Don't even talk about that film, please. Oof.
Well, there is a bit of humour.
Go on.
9 finds a bullet, an unspent bullet, and is about to whack it, and then you're like, ah! Don't do that. No, you're right. Yeah, I don't remember.
There's a subtle lightness to it. It is
interesting. One of them is, so they all look the same, like a Hessian sack.
Yeah.
Except one of them has, it looks like he's the boy in the striped pyjamas.
That's right. Yeah, yeah, yeah. He's like
obviously
painter,
Nazi
isn't he?
Reference, but it's like bloody hell.
Right.
Should we score it?
And also, in any film, when they play an old gramophone radio version of "Somewhere Over the Rainbow," oh Christ, shit's about to get bad.
Yeah. And the other thing, I thought it was quite a bland colour palette.
Oh, for God's sakes! No.
It's a post-apocalyptic world, mate.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Doom and gloom.
I recommend it. So parents out there, not even parents out there, people who are alone, people who, whatever, just trying life out for shits and giggles. Check this out. It's good fun.
It's all right.
It's good.
And then we've got a memorable scene or a memorable line.
So memorable scene, I quite like the weird cobra snake doll's head
thing
that comes after the...
Yes,
the soul sacks to get them back to the main, the main sentinel. That's all of that stuff is really like, oh Jesus, especially when the hood opens and you see the, as you were saying, Laurie, that baby's head, baby doll head.
Yeah,
that's good.
Yeah, Laurie.
Nah, not really.
Okay, I've got a memorable line. Some things in this world are better off left where they lie.
Yeah. And there is a really telegraphed line. Sometimes one must be sacrificed for the benefit of many, is said quite early by
quite
number
right
one.
Too.
And you sit there going, well, obviously at some point he's going to turn around and sacrifice himself, which, lo and behold, he does.
What do we think of Deborah Lorry's music?
I mean, they're quite a duo, aren't they?
Oh, God, they keep playing 80s stuff. It's very 80s vibe, wasn't it?
Yeah.
No. That was good. It was good music, wasn't it? It was good.
All right. Well, we better score it then before time runs out on us.
Yeah.
So, performances. Loring.
7.
I would have.
6.
5 for me. Effects. Would have.
7.
6. So, effects, we're going to have to talk about like design, shit like that, right? 8.
Well, yeah. They're not. Yeah. Well, yeah.
8.
Plot 4. I would say it's quite effect heavy since everything's an animation, computer animation.
Yeah.
6.
This is plot 4.
6.
Rewatch factor 1.
4. 3.
Direction with the
7.
5.
Yeah, that's
7. I did find actually, I mean, albeit it was very, very watchable and I didn't mind it, but I was very conscious there was just lots and lots of rescues. It was like attack, rescue, attack, rescue, attack, rescue. It was kind of driving the plot along.
And that guy just did my head in, the moaning one, which I am now realising that I might sound a bit like today. Don't go in there, don't do it! That guy.
Yeah.
Cinematography, 5.
7.
7.
Laurie, sound and music.
We did a great job. I'd give us a solid 7.
You should write to that composer.
Shouldn't I?
Yeah.
And offer some collaboration. Deborah Laurie with Deborah
Laurie. We could be the face of your music. Originality, 5. It's not original because of Terminator and all of the Dark Crystal. And
6.
Okay.
7.
Right. Enjoyability, 4.
5.
7.
And life-changing, past or present, 1.
0.
I'm going to give it a 2.
So I guess 38 from me.
55 from me.
10. 13. What the fuck am I? Okay, it's 11.
Flipping that.
14.
Never surprises me how long it takes to add up 10 numbers.
Yeah. And the way he does it as well, his method, that's
really bad.
That's a 61. It's a 61. I just attack it and just like look at numbers and I start smashing and then I like add that one to that one and then maybe I'll move that one over there and then I'll smash that one
that's
down.
That's your first problem.
Yeah.
And your only problem. Right, so come on.
And it gives us a Movie Lighthouse rating of 51.3.
Right, so, oh gosh, what was the other one? 58.3.
Yeah.
Right, so 51.3, that puts it obviously below District 9, but in the same place, really. Well, they're next to each other in a little one, but have a look at it. Might be different on the big leaderboard. 51.3, here we go. Right, so it puts it above The Puppet Master, but below Poltergeist 2. So...
It's better than Poltergeist 2.
It's not.
It is. Poltergeist 2 turns out to be a bit shit.
Well, I don't know.
But it's got a brilliant, brilliant baddie in it.
Yeah, I think it's quite good. We've already talked about that anyway. All right, so we have chosen our films for next time. And the category is 1979. That funny old year just before the 80s.
It's got to be rich, right? Rich in goods. I can't think of anything off the top of my head, but what do you got? What have you got? Come on.
All right. Well, my first offering to you, Mr. Laurie Wise, but don't be bitter about last time.
Never bitter.
Is Eraserhead.
Oh, that's a strong start.
Yes, it is.
Yes. Okay.
I thought you were making it up, but we can't hear you. I thought you were just pretending not to talk.
Sorry. I think that's my biggest frustration now. After 2 years of everybody living on Zoom, people still forgetting to take themselves off mute.
Why did you put yourself on mute?
Because I was blowing my nose and I didn't think you needed to hear that.
Oh, he's a gentleman, isn't he?
Okay, my first choice is Werner Herzog's Nosferatu the Vampire.
Yes. Which is great. And it's got our girl from Possession in it. I've forgotten her name.
Now, just bear in mind, we are not just a horror-based podcast.
Well, absolutely. I mean, Eraserhead's not horror.
Exactly. But maybe Nosferatu is. And my second choice, which is not horror, actually, is...
All right, I see what you're doing.
Close Encounters of the Third.
Oh, my God. 1979.
Do.
Yeah, so good. So good. Yeah.
Okay, so I went and got some secret support on this to help with the process so that we could provide some interesting films. And I'm ignoring all of that great advice.
Because I
tripped across another one, which is Quintet. It is a Robert Altman film with Paul Newman, based during a future ice age. Dying humanity occupies its remaining time by playing a board game called Quintet.
Oh, is it like Jumanji?
A little bit. Apparently, it's all sort of ritual murders and stuff like that.
There was no ritual murders in Jumanji. Monkey.
So, three of these, you know, big players, Eraserhead, seen it. Nosferatu, Werner Herzog, seen it. Close Encounters, seen it. All spectacular films. Quintet, never freaking heard of it. It's probably going to be awful. But I almost feel like I have to choose that one. Do you know what I mean? Do you know where I'm coming from?
I know exactly where you're coming from.
I know exactly where you're coming from as well.
So I do have...
This is so great.
I have to say, the person who has aided me in this has a list, which I'll share with you after you make your choice. All the ones I didn't
use. And there's just going to be some absolute beauties in there, aren't there?
Yeah.
Oh, God. See, this is going to take equally as long now. Well, I've just realised, because the choice is going to be also
starting to boil.
Shit. Okay, all right. Okay, so I have 1 minute.
No, you don't have a minute. Just make a flipping choice.
Right, okay, we're going to do Eraserhead, all right? We're doing Eraserhead.
You're not doing it for me.
I know I'm not doing it for you. Right, a razor banked. Head. Boom, that is in. Banked. And we're going to do quintet. We are going to go. Yeah, we're going to shine our beam into that darkness. Let's see what quintet gives us.
Oh, an early version of Jumanji, by all accounts. All right, so we are going to be back hopefully a little sooner than last time because we are, for the first time ever, we have not been able to come to you in the month of March. So we apologise.
My fault.
All of you who need us to get through March, never mind. We'll see you again in April, hopefully.
Do you want to hear very quickly the other options for 79?
Well, yes, please.
So no, this
but
is
let's
obviously...
not let the listener hear them. Let's just us.
Oh, okay.
Now go on. Stop it.
So this is from our Canadian correspondent. So you can well imagine.
I could smell it all over this.
Some punchy stuff in here. Stalker by Andrei Tarkovsky.
Brilliant film.
Peter Sellers being there.
Yeah, good.
I've heard of these films.
Connor suggested Werner Herzog's Nosferatu.
Yeah.
When a Stranger Calls, which is the original, he's in the house shocker. Scum by with Ray Winston in it. Driller Killer.
Yes.
The 36th Chamber of Shaolin, which apparently is instrumental in the mythology of the Wu-Tang Clan.
Right, yeah.
Wise Blood.
Nope.
Don't know that one.
Haven't seen that one.
And then he came up with a couple just to mess with you, James. Films that are set in 1979 rather than being made in 1979. He recommends 20th Century Women and The Boys from Brazil.
Yeah.
I wanted to go for Boys from Brazil, but every time I looked at it, it said 1978. And evidently I'm a rule abider.
Yeah. And I've never seen it. And I keep reading all about it and seeing bits of it. I'm like, oh, God, I've got to check that out. But anyway, one day it shall happen.
Well, fortunately then, for those very reasons of not breaking rules with them, your offer entries have to be disqualified. Or because the whole point is that you choose your own films, not get somebody else to do it.
No, so the whole point was
to choose more interesting films. Now, do we?
We do. Yeah, we do. I'm excited.
A Razorhead and Quintet.
Yeah.
All right.
Laurie and I have to dig out films, Video Nasties.
Video Nasties. Okay,
yeah.
Fantastic.
You better put Clockwork Orange on there, one of you.
Yeah, you can do that, Win.
We'll see.
I'll give you a list, Win, if you want. Perfect. Right, guys. Au revoir. See you all.
See you a bit. Bye. Bye-bye.